A bunch of bizarre new household trends are sweeping our suburbs. For the last 100 years, the average Australian household size has been on the decline until now. These days, more and more people from different families or multiple generations are living under one roof, giving a whole new meaning to the phrase, one big happy family.
Yeah, happy, yeah, right. By next year, for the first time ever, researchers predict the traditional nuclear family will be no longer the norm.
So, what are the top new living situations taking over Aussie households? Social analyst and demographer Mark McCrindle joins us now. Mark, the nuclear family unit, is it a thing of the past?
Well, it has been declining for a century, as you said, from 4.5 people back in 1911 to 2.5 people. But just in the last couple of years, it's turned around. We're up to 2.6 people. And it's not that necessarily families are getting larger, it's more the households are getting larger. So we've got blended families, extended families, group households, because of financial reasons, more people under the one roof, and so bigger households.
So you're talking about this multi-generation household, which we might find in sort of European or Asian cultures as the norm. You're talking about that becoming the norm now. Why is that?
Yeah, exactly. And in some ways, it's a return to the old days, 50 or 60 years ago. You know, the parents were getting old. You bring them into your own home when they couldn't cope any longer. The kids stayed at home until they were married. That's what we have now, only both of those incidents are happening at the same time. So you've got the older parents coming into one's home right at the time the kids are sticking around and still there, and so you've suddenly got three generations under the one roof, just like, you know, in the olden days.
So we've got a phenomenon. This is the boomerang phenomenon. This is crazy. So all the young kids are staying with mum and dad for how long?
Well, indefinitely is the good news for parents. It's actually, you've got about half that are staying home and not moving. You've got about half that leave home in their early 20s, but return on back. Majority within 2 years, they boomerang on back just because of the cost of living. And they're studying later in life. It's hard to get a foothold in the property market, so it's certainly a lot cheaper being with mum and dad.
Have you come up with a number? Is there an amount of money that we can say kids save by moving back home?
Yeah, if you look at even a modest amount of rent they'd be paying, if they're sharing accommodation, about $300 a week. You work that out over a year, that's about $15,000 in rent that they're saving. If they can cut back by parents paying for the electricity and the water, maybe a bit of the food there as well on the parents' tab, suddenly you're up to about $20,000 a year. Now you do that for a couple of years and there's a deposit for a mortgage, so it's pretty significant.
That sounds
You've got
nice,
to start remembering
it?
To put the toilet seat down again when you move back.
What sort of pressure does that put financially then on the mums and dads if the kids aren't kicking the tin?
Well, a lot of parents are happy to do it to give their kids a bit of a head start in life, you know, because when they bought homes, 1973, the average house in a capital city in Australia was 5 times average annual earnings. Today, it's 10 times average annual earnings. So it's just getting harder and harder to buy a house. But the downside is the cost for the parents. They're funding the living of their 20-something, sometimes even hitting the 30s. And what it means is that, in a sense, they could have downsized to a smaller, more appropriate house. They can't because the kids are there. There's an opportunity cost there. They could have invested the extra money and really looked at retirement. So a lot of them are working later in life because the kids are hanging around.
Mum and Dad, change the locks quick while you can. You've also seen some changes in recent years the way couples are living together. What are those significant changes, would you say?
Well, of those marriages that end up leading to divorce, it happens after about 9 years of marriage on average, and there's normally young kids involved. And if you're at late 30s, early 40s, two young kids, most people can't afford to get a second home if the marriage splits up. And so they have to increasingly live under the one roof, perhaps share a little bit of the parenting role. So that's great for the kids. They get both parents
free around. Babysitting.
Free babysitting. It's a little bit awkward, though, for the family that's split up but under the one roof. But just for many households, it's impossible to get that second home at that stage and in this financial situation.
All right, good stuff. Thank you, mate. Always interesting to talk.